Tonight about my career in the army band, which I'm coming to the end of it. And it's a career in which I was both way more successful than I had ever hoped to dream of, and also failed harder than I can even still now believe. So that first piece I played for you was Papayala. It was up on the screen. You know that. The next piece I'm going to play, you know this too, Winter's Exile. I was fortunate enough to be able to collaborate with a poet who's my neighbor, Robert Bland. And he wrote this beautiful poem that really struck me at my core. And to kind of explain that a little bit, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about myself. I was born in Fargo, North Dakota, in March of 1972. And in much of the country, March is a time when the new life of spring is evident. Early bloomers are blooming, the weather's warming, and the grass is green. I know you don't have the green grass here, but... Well, in North Dakota, there's no such evidence. The snow might be gone, but that leaves bare brown grass, bare dirt fields, and the few trees there are have no sign of life. It's a very barren landscape. When you live in North Dakota, the hope of this life that spring brings, the hope for that return, has to be held on faith alone. When I was young, in my springtime, my life was full of music. I studied and fell in love, and all was as it should be. You are falling in love with the crocuses. It has never happened before. Enthralled by those velvet violet petals, seduced by that stealth yellow stinger. You love the dirt up under your nails, breaking the land in the cool morning sun, singing soft to the seeds and the first budding trees. The equinox is coming. Soon, those long-growing days and zephyr-filled nights shall assert themselves and then disappear. Were they ever here? So hard to know, to beat back the frost. And on these days, you just do not care if the rites of spring encroach on winter's freedom. It's the crocuses, and what they promise to bring, that have you fallen in love again. Sustaining the absurd rhythm of our off-key orb askew. don't stop. Music is a universal language. It crosses boundaries of language, culture, race, and gender to bring people together into a community. And I was sick, and yet I yearn for this idea, for music that brings people into a community and it speaks to everyone. And I've seen it happen. I've spoken through my instrument and I've seen people respond. Strangers. Normally we would pass each other by without comment. But here, somehow with the music, we are connected. And oftentimes, as we come together and we're drawn closer and closer through the music, I come to this realization. This is too close, you smell bad, and I think you might be high. I would like to step back and get back up on stage. Did I mention that I'm in a rock band and we play a number of festivals? Almost got my teeth knocked out about 3 weeks ago, but they were so into it. Man, they love it. But in all seriousness, I have really enjoyed the connection I've made with my students through music. I have some students who are free to be creative and inquisitive in their lessons, and I ask them what they want to learn. And believe it or not, they tell me they want to learn music theory. So we talk about music structure and its rules, and we notice the artful breaking of those rules. And I write pieces of music for them to explore their questions and ideas. And this one, this next piece is one such piece. I wrote this for John, who is still my student. He is a senior in high school this year. And when I was going to write this for him, he told me, "Ms. Warfield, I think I need to work on 16th notes and octaves." And this makes a lot of people giggle when they think of a piece of 16th notes and octaves, you know, together like that. But my piece will not make you evil. In fact, it's kind of sad. And John titled it, because of course it's his piece, he titled it La Mujer Que No Aprende, because he speaks Spanish, and it means the woman who doesn't learn. For some reason, he surrounded it with question marks, so I guess it's a woman who doesn't learn.
Thank you.
are two values that I've used to guide me on my musical journey. A number of years ago, I decided to create a mission statement for myself to help keep me focused on my values as a musician and an artist. So here it is. Sound good, keep it simple, but be different. So what's the reason for this focus? Well, sound good, that should be fairly obvious, right? That's what we're all here in music school to do. We want to sound good for ourselves, for our teachers, for our colleagues, and for our audience. Keep it simple. I find that often in institutions such as schools of music, that difficult is equated with good, and simple is devalued. For me, I find, however, that if something is simple and beautiful or meaningful and expressive, it's a great value to me because it has none of the artifice that comes with the difficult. To me, simplicity lends itself to sincerity. That brings us to the last point. Be different. My intent in being different is to find and exploit those things that are unique to me. If I can create my own unique musical voice, I can capture the authenticity that I value. Sound good, keep it simple, but be different. Now, I've often felt out of place at conference festivals such as the ATW or the ITF. And this is because, rightly or wrongly, I have felt that my values don't match those of the organizations. And this is because so often what is on display there is the difficult. Displays of impressive virtuosity. And I feel that it's often at the expense of the music and creativity. I go to concerts at these events not to hear the music, but to judge the skill of the performer. And I come away thinking that talent is wasted on the uninspired. And I scratch my head and I think, if you clearly can play anything you want, why are you playing that? And let me be straight with you, I can't play anything I want. I have a lot of limitations. But I know this about myself, and I use this understanding to help me create my unique voice. Because with creativity, you can make something out of nothing, and I can move forward as long as I'm focusing not on what I can't play, but on what I can play. It's those values, simplicity and authenticity that keep me grounded. So the next piece I'm going to play for you is brand new. It's a world premiere. It's called Deconstructed Riff. And for quite a while, I've been wanting to write a piece in the minimalist style, but with a language other than classical, like a jazz riff. And it all came together for me one night when I was walking my dogs. On our route, there are three churches that we pass. And on any given night, there might be sounds coming out of these churches, one or more of them. Amplified, muffled voices, music. And it's pulsating, it's rhythmic, it's hypnotic. And you can't understand exactly what's going on in there, but you can get the idea. Do you believe? Yes, I believe. Do you believe? Yes, I believe. Do you believe? Yes, I believe. That sort of spiritual communication where the repetition is very meaningful. Now, I subtitle my piece, As the Spirit Moves You, because I want the performer to put themselves in that place of spiritual communication. So now it's time to preach.
Thank you.
very difficult music. It seemed like each piece was more difficult than the last. And I like learning and solving problems, but beyond that, I wasn't getting a lot of fulfillment out of the whole music thing. But then I left school, I became a professional, and I continued to work on those very difficult pieces, because that's just what you do as a professional musician. But I started to think that what I was actually learning was to hate music. And I found that counterproductive, because I was getting tied up in knots, and the anxiety was affecting my playing. And this was nothing new. You see, for much of my life, music has been like a bad boyfriend. He treated me mean. I'd do anything for him. But when I needed him, he just wasn't there. When it came time to perform, my heart and head would race, and the music wouldn't come. I'd see music off having a good time with somebody else. They didn't love him like I did, and broke my heart. I didn't want to go to concerts. I was like going out and watching my man cheat on me. I wanted to have that, and it wasn't looking like I ever would. But then, I started noticing these people who were having a great time with music, who had way less skills than I did. They didn't go to music school. They might not even read music. And I heard these folk recordings. Simple, beautiful, and meaningful. And I knew there was hope for me. There had to be a way. So I tooled down my repertoire, threw out all the old wisdom, and started over. I decided I had to trust myself and my values. And I started writing music for myself. And this next piece, I wrote so that I could experience joy with my instrument. This is Mangabey Rag.
Thank you.
or wanting to feel things when I play music, or at all. I got that a lot from my army band colleagues. Feeling things is so uncool and unprofessional. She's not a player. She's just a showman. But I want to feel things. It's how I know I'm alive. And it brings fulfillment to my life. And it's something that I value in music. But it turns out that was a fundamental disagreement between me and the army band when it came to music making. If you doubt me, I ask you just to watch a few videos of the band. If you see anything that resembles feeling, it's probably going to be misery. So, music and I have a pretty good relationship now. I found the joy. I found the fulfillment. And for me, that is a great success. But it came at a cost. In the place where I've spent the last 19 and a half years, I had to fight to hang on to my path to find that joy and that fulfillment. And that fight had a backlash. And that backlash brought me a shocking and surprising amount of pain. And this brings us to our last two pieces on the program. Music that I wrote to process that pain. Because music through it all remains my salvation. And it works here to cleanse me of the pain and the darkness. And you play a part in that. And I really appreciate you being here to absorb some of that. Because it's a relief to me. So we're going to a dark place, a place where I've been beat down. I would describe my career as the first female trombonist ever hired by the United States Army Band, Pershing Zone, as a slow burn. For 10 years, it smoldered with enough intensity to motivate me to try to make it. But then, the flames were fanned. The flames were fanned. And the fire grew year upon year, always hotter, until it raged out of control. The intensity of it consumed me and turned me to ash. Soldiers came and put my fire out.
Washing is how the day began.
Claim the title of artist. And I won't be denied. regrettable it had to end so badly, but now that I'm at the end, I can see it's all for the best, as I can now pursue my dreams more fully. And remember, this is why I'm here. You can't know what lies ahead, but I'm hoping I've shown you the importance of resilience and the cost.